Yes, please.
Good afternoon. Thank you all for being engaged citizens by joining us here today for this town hall. My name is Molly and I'm a senior at Fallon High School. Being in high school, I know firsthand what it's like to be constantly afraid in what's supposed to be a safe environment. Last year in May, my school was evacuated due to a phone call regarding a suspicious person entering the school with a duffel bag. Within minutes, the SWAT team and what appeared to be the entire Fallon Police Force surrounded the building and ran through the hallways yelling for everyone to get out. There were many tears as everyone sprinted out of the school and ran down the road to Nativity Church. While the whole ordeal turned out to be one big misunderstanding, the emotions we felt that day are not what we'll soon forget. We thought our lives were on the line. Nobody, especially not students in the walls of their own school, should ever have to feel that way. Since the Parkland shooting on February 14th, student activists across the country have come out in full force to rally for common sense gun legislation. It is estimated that over 800,000 people marched in Washington alone on March 24th. If this is correct, the event would be the largest single-day protest in the history of our nation's capital. This doesn't even include the over 800 sister protests in other cities across the nation and the world. But the movement did stop on March 24th. Activists across the country have organized town halls like this one here today, covering over 150 congressional districts with the goal of giving constituents the opportunity to directly ask questions to the representatives regarding solutions to gun violence. This is going to be an open dialogue where you are all free to offer your best ideas in terms of how to avoid horrors like the Parkland shooting from ever happening again in America. Feel free to share a personal story you may have on the subject. These stories are often what drive legislation as they're more meaningful than the statistics on a spreadsheet. Let's all be respectful and hopefully we'll make some progress on this significant issue. Thank you.
Thank you, Molly. My name is Andrew Austin. I'm chair of Democracy and Justice Studies at the University of Wisconsin-Green Bay. My background is sociology. My area of expertise, is in criminology. But that's not the only reason why I'm interested in this subject. I have a 13-year-old who's in the public school system, and so I share that immediate sense of anxiety the parents have about public safety and school safety. I want to thank you all for coming. This is a very important discussion. I want to thank Bodie Joyce for being here and to the organizers of this event for inviting me to participate and for having this event. Tonight, Bodie Joyce will be speaking with us about his thoughts and policy ideas concerning these issues. Bo is an assistant prosecutor in the Brown County District Attorney's Office. Bo graduated from Southwest High School. He lives in Alloway with his wife and daughter, who many of us had the pleasure of meeting at a recent March for Our Lives event. Very precious. I want to recognize that Bo serves in the Wisconsin Army National Guard as a military lawyer. And Bo is running for Congress for the 8th District, the seat currently held by Mike Gallagher. Before turning over the mic to Bo, I want to thank the Union Congregationalist United Church of Christ for providing this wonderful space for our event. On a personal note, my father is a Church of Christ minister, and I grew up in the Church of Christ. So it's a real pleasure to be here. The Coalition for Voting Organizations and Moms Demand Action for Gun Sense in America of Green Bay for helping to organize this event. Thank you so much. And Terry Lee from SAML. Thank you, Terry. Second, I want to assure this audience that an invitation was extended to Congressman Gallagher to participate. Congressman Gallagher's office informed us that he could not be here, would not be here today. However, his office did send a statement, and at this time I would like to invite Shirley Paulson to read Congressman Gallagher's statement.
I'm Shirley Paulson, and I'm just reading the statement that the office sent over. I want to tell you why I'm here, though, first of all. I'm a mom and a grandma, and I have my only grandson is about 4 years old, and the day after Parkland, my daughter called me and said, should we buy him a bulletproof vest? And I thought, things have to change. Before I retired, I was an elementary school principal, and part of what we had to do in our schools was to conduct active shooter drills, and we did it. We did it because we had to. But it broke my heart that these tiny little four-year-old children had to learn how to hide in case somebody was in our school trying to kill them. I'm also here because I'm attached to the group called Moms Demand Gun Sense. And on Thursday, I had the opportunity to be in Madison for an advocacy day for that group. And it was amazing. Moms Demand Action is a group that formed right after Sandy Hook because mom said something has to change here. In our advocacy work on Thursday at the Capitol, we did some training in the morning, and then we went over to the Capitol and we met with representatives, or we met, in some cases they weren't there, the senators, the assembly people weren't there, so we met with our staff people. We didn't only go to the ones who we knew would agree with us. We went to people on both sides of the issue, and our goal was to establish relationships with these people and to try to find common ground. And I think that's something that is sadly missing in America right now, trying to find common ground. I feel very strongly that people in entrenched positions who won't even listen to the other side. So it is my duty now, but it's also, I'm also very okay with this, to read what Mike Gallagher sent over, okay? He says, Congressman Gallagher says, I'm heartbroken by the taking of so many innocent lives by gun violence in America. No parent should have to worry about their child's safety at school, no child should be endangered in their place of learning, and no citizen should have to feel unsafe. Alarming reports show that some of the shootings we have seen over the last few years may have been preventable, and serious questions need to be answered about how our agencies fail to work together. Our schools, families, and communities cannot tolerate breakdowns in the system that we rely on to protect us, and we need to investigate exactly where the failures occur. I have been and continue to be fully committed to working with my colleagues in both parties, especially through my service on the Homeland Security Committee and a bipartisan group called Problem Solvers Caucus, which is made up of half Democrats and half Republicans. We must work together to make our country a safer place for our children and every person. So that's on behalf of Mike Gallagher. Thank you.
So one last thing before I have Bo up. There will be a question, answer, discussion period. So as you listen to Bo's thoughts on this, collect your own thoughts and think of the questions that you would like to ask and the points you'd like to make. I'm also aware that not all of us are comfortable speaking in public. So if you want to write your comments down on a piece of paper, and there are some note cards in the back for you to do so, I'll be happy to read questions and comments that you have, okay? But I would like to ask you also that you identify yourself so that we can get to know you a little bit better. That's great, okay? So without further ado, Bo Lee Joyce, welcome.
Thank you so much for having me here today. Okay, I think it's on now. Thank you so much for having me here today. It's just so inspiring that this is a movement led by students, like the students we have here today. This is the third event of this type that I've attended. I think that I come from a pretty unique perspective on gun safety policy. Being a career prosecutor, being a military reservist myself in the Wisconsin Army National Guard, and being a husband, my wife Katie is here today, and it's been very difficult her running for office for these last 7 months, but she has just been so fantastic, and I thank her so much. But more important than that, I'm a father. I have a one-year-old daughter at home, and my journey right here today started on August 1st, 2016, when my daughter was born. And for the parents that are in the audience today, I mean, you know that from the moment that parent, or the moment that the doctor hands you that first child of yours, and you're holding it in your arms, everything changes, all of your priorities change. It is like a lightning bolt going off inside you. And that's truly the inspiration for why I'm running here today. Another part of my background that I think is very enlightening to the current circumstances our country finds in is that I feel like these mass shooting incidents kind of line up with specific points in my own life. When the Columbine mass shooting happened in 1999, I myself was a junior in high school at Green Bay Southwest. And I just remember that day us looking around going, it could have been us, it could have been members cares about our community. And then there was the Virginia Tech shooting, mass shooting, and I was a college student at the time of that shooting. Then there was the movie theater shooting at an Aurora, Colorado movie theater, and that was at a midnight screening of the movie The Dark Knight Rises. And I myself was at a midnight screening of the movie at the same time, but I was at Bay Park Square in Ashwaubenon. And when we were leaving the movie theater that night, we were all finding out about it on our cell phones and just thinking that it could have been us, it could have been members of our community. And then when the Parkland shooting occurred in February, this one was different for me, because for the first time I thought, it could have been my daughter. So she is truly the inspiration for why I'm running here today. And I think that there are common sense gun safety policies that we can be putting forward. And I think that common sense means policies that the vast majority, a supermajority of American citizens can agree with. And what do I think those are? Number one, a bump stock ban. It has been over 6 months since the Las Vegas shooting, and there was basically unanimous support for banning bump stocks and devices that turn semi-automatic weapons into fully automatic weapons. And now it's over 6 months later, and there's still no bump stock ban. Even the president wants to ban these things, and Congress still, I think it's one of the best examples of Congress's inability to really do anything for us. They can't even get a bump stock ban in place. Number two, the universal background checks. I haven't been going around in the community and hearing a lot of people say that felons, domestic abusers, and people with mental illness should be able to get firearms. The only way to completely prevent them from getting firearms is to have a universal background check system. Number three, I think that there should be a universal waiting period. You should not be able to walk into a sporting goods store and walk out right there with a firearm. I myself am a firearm owner, and I remember walking into Cabela's and walking out 10 minutes later with a shotgun. So I was very, very surprised that was the procedure that took place, and I think that there should be a waiting period. Fourth, I think there should be a limit on the capacity of magazines. I had a case, I believe it was in 2014, where it was a large-scale drug trafficking case, and they also had many, many firearms. What I found most surprising, though, was that they had 100-round drums for magazines. And I found that to be very shocking that people could just have 100-round magazines. And I think that that's completely ridiculous. Another thing that I support, and this is number five, is red flag laws, giving families and law enforcement the tools to remove firearms from what could be a very volatile situation for mental health or domestic violence. And then number six, I think that we need to have a significant investment into our mental health treatment infrastructure in this country. I know from my...
Yes.
There are my class. I know from my experience in the criminal justice system that this is a significant issue that we face on a daily basis in the criminal justice system. There are resources out there, but there need to be significantly more resources available for mental health treatment in this country. And I think it's probably even worse in our rural communities where there are less resources available. And that's something that the federal government can step into and provide to our rural communities and every community to increase the level of mental health, level of access to mental health treatment that there is. So those are the six policies that I think are common sense solutions that we can have a supermajority to pass as actual legislation at the federal level. And I will open it up for questions at this point.
My name is Paul Bartlett, and I live in Alloway, Wisconsin. And I appreciate that you're here. And this is not really a question unless you want it to be a question. I'm going to say this because in Northeast Wisconsin, not too many people are going to say this, but it is high time that the Congress of this country and the states in this country repeal the Second Amendment. There is not a protection afforded that cannot be done legislatively to protect responsible gun owners from owning their guns. Gun policy in this country, and it's far beyond gun policy, is completely controlled by the NRA. If the NRA represented any kind of majority of the population, I could understand that. But there are 5 million members of the NRA. There's 340 million people who live in this country. The NRA has a membership which is 1.5% the population of the United States. But through its muscle and its intimidation and its association with people like the Koch brothers, Wayne LaPierre, who really runs the NRA, they have dictated gun policy in this country for way, way, way too long. And they are so far from the intent of the Second Amendment that we're on different planets when we try to have a conversation with them. And if we can't discuss these things without being labeled as left-wing whack jobs, a label which I don't mind having, by the way, then I think it's time that the NRA and the totally irresponsible gun lobby, it loses its constitutional privilege. We have many interests in this country. And in the case of Wisconsin, I guess it would be beer. It's handled through the legislative process. It is not handled through a constitutional process. And I think it's time. Now, I know that's not the kind of thing that you as a candidate can really be out addressing. But me, I'm not a candidate. I'm just an old tree hugger. But I think it's time. I think it's time. Pull the privilege away from the NRA and pull it away from the 1.5% of the population that belongs to the NRA. It's only 5 million out of 340 million people. So, I think you get my point.
Thank you for sharing your opinion. That's what town halls are all about. I mean, we're participating in the democracy that our founding fathers envisioned right now. I do support the Second Amendment. However, I do think that do support reasonable restrictions, which have been upheld by the Supreme Court basically throughout our country's entire history. I mean, if you agree with taking firearms away from felons, that's a reasonable restriction. I think there's a reason why the founding fathers made it the number 2 amendment, and that's because it was important to them. The second half of that question was about the NRA. I have not received or been offered any campaign funds from the NRA. I don't expect them to ever offer them to me, because this is the third time I've done an event like this. The NRA traditionally has done some very valuable things, and they continue to do so, like firearm safety for children, hunter safety type courses. But where I have a significant disagreement with them is that they refuse to compromise on anything, on any of these common sense gun safety proposals that are being offered. I myself am a member at the DePere Sportsman Club, and I'm a member at this particular club because they don't require you to also be an NRA member. I enjoy target shooting at the DePere Sportsman Club when I have leisure time, which is not very often anymore. Thank you for coming.
Other questions?
Hi, my name is Janet Bankowski. I am a parent of 2 young children, young middle school children, and I've been watching following very closely ever since before Parker, of course, but it was a really turning point for me because I don't want to live like this. My children don't want to live like this anymore. And I'm tired of sending my kids to school every day, telling them that as a parent, my job is to keep them safe and that I will keep them safe. And knowing every day when I do that and send them in, I'm lying to them. I have to stop lying and I have to do more. So I've committed myself to every day learning and doing something on this topic. Little stuff, coming, educating myself, reading something, learning. So my question to you is, you each ticked off six very straightforward, common sense, reasonable, logical things that I think people on both sides of the political spectrum could agree to. And again, I've been trying to watch all things developing on this topic locally, statewide, and nationally. Are you aware of any legislation that's been has been proposed or is moving forward at either a state or a federal level addressing any of those? Is any, so my broader question, is anything legislatively moving?
In this particular state, I don't think that there's anything pending on these six items that I mentioned. One thing that I will add is empowering our law enforcement officers to protect our children in the schools. I think that there was a legislation in Wisconsin for that, which I think is a step forward. But I don't think there's anything in Congress that's being offered along these lines, and that's the whole problem.
We're almost 2 months out, and not one thing.
Yeah, and that's the problem, is that so many people agree with these six things that I've offered today, and there's just no action from Congress, and nothing is not a solution when we know what's happening in our schools.
This mic is not going to be
My name is Lindy Reed, and I really work in West Green Bay. And like this woman too, Parkland is kind of just the edge. My granddaughter is in college studying to be an elementary school teacher. And the thought of her having to jump in front of a student just can't deal with it. But of the six things, I agree with all six of those, but I don't think I heard you address assault rifles. Do you have a standpoint on how you feel on abandoning those?
I don't think that we should be banning specific firearms, because I think that if we start talking about that, we're going to be alienating millions more people, and then the six things that I mentioned as common sense solution will never get passed. They will never get passed if we start talking about banning specific firearms. So I do not advocate for that.
Hi, my name is Maria Bridges. I wanted to know how you feel about having armed police officers in schools, because I see that that's something that some people are advocating for, or even advocating for having armed teachers in schools. So I just want to know what you think about that. And I'm going to add, as a person of color, I'm a little bit fearful about having armed police officers in schools. But
yeah. The very simple answer in the question is that I do not support arming teachers. I do not think that that's a solution. I think that it's going to create more danger. So that one's a very straightforward answer. In terms of protecting our students, I do support empowering our law enforcement to protect our children in the schools. I think that law enforcement should be the only ones that are allowed to bring a firearm in school. An actual trained law enforcement officer who spends their career training for that. And in this community, I know from my personal experience of reviewing police reports all day long and talking to police officers, we are blessed with the world-class law enforcement agencies in this community who exercise an incredible amount of restraint on a daily basis. And when I was growing up in Southwest, we had a police liaison officer right there in the school. And that officer was very good at engaging with students, getting to know us on a first-name basis, recognizing our faces, and no threats I'm aware of ever propped up, but I think that he would have probably been in a really good position to recognize a threat before it happened by developing relationships with all students.
Hi, my name is
Dan.
I'm from Wisconsin. I'm a teacher and wondering how you would framing the conversation so that we can be more productive and our leaders can hear this more productively.
Would you frame it as a public health and safety issue rather than gun control, or how would you see framing the issue so that we can make progress?
Yeah, I think it's absolutely a gun safety issue, violence prevention, and I think focusing on the six things that I've offered here today that the vast majority of people are going to agree with is going to be the winning strategy. And after November, we'll be able to actually get action in Congress on.
Applied to purchase a gun. So I was making sure that particular offices know that certain people are looking to buy guns. And so it was, I mean, that was highlighted the first week or so after Parkland to say, like, see, we're doing something. But those may be two bills that people want to watch. The second one has like 42 co-sponsors.
Okay. Thank you, Sharon.
Hi, Paul. My name is Danny Cole. I live in Amherst, Wisconsin. I am the father of four, grandfather of 10, great-grandfather of 1. Eight of those children have gone to public school, and one is too young, or two are too young. So, I just want to know where you stand on straw bans, which is whenever you pass a law, somebody circumvents it. Straw buyers, they buy a gun from someone who can't qualify to buy a gun, and then they get off scot-free. Would you be in favor of a law that anybody that buys a gun is responsible for any crime that that gun is involved in? And if they say, well, somebody stole it, then that's their responsibility, in my opinion, to make sure that nobody can steal it. So they would, like, pay a percentage of that crime, you know, be prosecuted. Also, I am a gun owner. I deer hunt. I have 5 guns, and it's not the guns exclusively, but the law gets the guns in the wrong hands and the wrong kind of guns that are the problem.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you for the question. I don't know if you can get criminal liability out of that as a prosecutor or not, because most crimes do involve an intent. But I will tell you that there presently is a law in Wisconsin that it's a felony to furnish a firearm to a felon. So, I mean, that this is what we have police and prosecutors for. I mean, if a citizen sees something like that happen, then they should report it to the police will investigate it, and they'll refer it to the DA's office for to review for a charge. But presently it is a felony to furnish a firearm to a felon. But you have to knowingly do it.
What about something like liability insurance, like requiring all firearm owners to hold insurance the way an automobile has to hold insurance?
That's actually the first time I've heard that being brought up. It's obviously not one of the 6 things I'm proposing here today. So what I would tell you is that sounds like something that's going to alienate a lot of people if that's brought into the discussion. And if we alienate people, we're not going to get these 6 common sense solutions passed through Congress. So that's what I'm focusing on.
So I have a question right here.
Yes, this is Ann Minster. Actually, it's a point of clarification that the Senate bill that this gentleman referred to, the Fix Mix Act, was passed. It's the National Instant Criminal Background Check System. That was co-sponsored by both the Democrats, Senator Chris Murphy out of Connecticut, and Senator John Cornyn of Texas. And they introduced that following the shooting in Sutherland, Texas, because it was felt that if there had been better coordination of information between systems, that shooting could have been prevented. Okay, so, and that bill did pass as it was inserted into the budget. So when the budget passed, the Fix Mix Act was part of that bill, part of the budget bill. Appropriations.
Thank you. Two questions for you over here. One, the big thing for it is getting experts involved. That includes obviously law enforcement. So when it comes to any passage of any bill, obviously having law enforcement is crucial to hearing what they need and think they need to be able to ensure our safety and children's safety. Another thing too that I'd like to see if you could incorporate as step 7 of your plan is to, I don't know the exact amendment, or it's going to be a provision where the CDC cannot study gun violence. That is put in, I think, over 2 decades ago.
That has been a change since Parkland. They did put money into their
study. Well, I think there's still a law, though.
They just needed the permission to investigate.
Yeah, so decades ago, I believe, with pushing of the NRA, they said the CDC banned them from studying gun violence, which is ridiculous. They study car accidents, they study diseases, you know, stuff like that, and cause of that. So I think gun safety and gun violence and how to end that preventable deaths, I think should be hopefully part of your plan to consider that.
Yes, thank you. I support researching gun violence in this country. And honestly, I support researching just about anything. And I think that's one of the fundamental failings of this Congress is that they don't have open public hearings about anything anymore. And I think that's one of the problems. I think I'll let one of the students ask a question at this point.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You talked about things like officers in police schools and not police schools, regular schools. And I was wondering, when I've seen this stuff online, who do you think should judge whether when a police officer is ready to respond to an active shooter situation in a school? Because this is very different. You have children involved, and that can be very traumatizing to police officers. So I'm wondering, how do you judge that?
So you're saying that when there's an active shooter situation taking place, who should judge what the police officer does?
When they're ready to handle
this. Well, I have a pretty high level of faith in our local law enforcement here in particular, who I'm familiar with. The police officers this is something that they do for their career. Like, they go to, their educational background is in training for situations like an active shooter situation, and they have substantially more training and just seen a variety of things in their training than a regular person does. So I think trusting our law enforcement to protect our schools is a much, much better option than Army teachers, say. Yeah, I know this is one of the things that Congress probably could do is offer increased funding for local police departments to have specific training into responding to active shooter situations in schools. And I'm guessing that they already do have a lot of training like that, because I think when they do trainings like that, it does make the news, and I believe I've seen that. But there's certainly, this is such a crisis situation right now that the more training, the better, and I think that most police officers would agree that they'll always accept more training. So
I have a question over
here. Hi, I'm Chris Rogers. I live in Ledgeview, and I wanted to talk about banning the assault and military style automatic weapons. That has been a right for the state since the Supreme Court, I think, in 1998 passed the law that it was okay to ban assault rifles. I think that was allowed to expire sometime in the 2000s, but just yesterday there was another case. A federal court upheld the right of a state to ban military-style semi-automatic guns and assault rifles, like those used in mass murders recently. This was in Massachusetts. U.S. District Court ruled that this ban on assault weapons and large magazines is legal because those high-capacity guns and rifles fall outside of the scope of the personal right to bear arms under the Second Amendment.
Yes.
This ruling upholds the rights of the states to enforce those bans, and I think that we can do it.
Eagle River is a lot different than Chicago, that's a district court decision. I'm anticipating that it'll probably be appealed, and there's never a final answer until the Supreme Court has it said.
But thank you for sharing. Thank you.
Questions back here?
We're going to have... Well, that's another one up here.
Okay,
that's
all right. That's great.
Ask what you, in your eyes, view as most influential for us students to do, since most of us in high school can't vote yet. What you think is important for us to do to give the attention or the government to make changes happen?
I mean, to be honest with you, what you're doing right now is getting... Remember that there's a First Amendment, and you can say whatever you want in this country, and nobody has to listen to it, but you have as much freedom as you want to say it, and you're having a pretty large collective voice right now. It's very inspiring.
We're listening.
Thank you for being here. My name is Jan Schreiber, and I'm from Shawano. And it's not really a question so much, but I kind of just wanted to end this up with a comment. I hope they don't start crying. In our little school district, we have, our town is about 9,000 people. In the last 2 weeks, we have had two threats of someone coming in and shooting up the schools. We have had police swarming all over our schools during the day. I take my 7-year-old grandson to school in the morning and sit and have breakfast with him. And we had the last threat the night before last. So I took him yesterday morning for breakfast, and it looked like there was maybe only half the amount of kids that normally would have been in school. So these kids are so, their parents are so scared. They don't want to send their kids to school. And we don't know who's doing this. Obviously, I don't know if it would be the FBI that's helping them. Yes. But what really got to me yesterday, I was walking out of the school, and there was a teacher standing in the doorway trying to convince this little boy to come into school. And that kid wasn't budging. The trauma on these kids, and this is only up to second grade. And this young gentleman mentioned the trauma on the officers, which must be horrible. But to think that 7-year-olds will argue with the teacher, I'm not going to. That's all I don't know if I have a question about that, but I just, it really affected me so much. But this whole thing has, I've been in this for months already. Wow.
Thank you so much for the comment. That sounds like a very right now issue, so thank you for sharing.
Could people use the microphone closer to the mouth?
Sure.
Here.
Absolutely. So my name is Megan Borcher, and I have two questions. One, would it be, actually three, now that I'm thinking about it. One, would it be more beneficial to have CIT trained officers in schools? Those are crisis intervention officers instead of just resource officers. Two, can we get trauma-informed care in schools? And three, what do you think local, city, and counties can do to help move this along?
Yeah, thank you. Why don't you stay there, because that was three different questions. Yeah, the first one was CIT-trained officers.
Correct.
I mean, I'm not 100% familiar with the
So, like, but mental health officers. And we do have some of those in Brown County, both in Green Bay. I believe De Pere and Ashwaubenon also have them. They're more mental health crisis or crisis intervention officers. So, like, if somebody's having a mental health crisis, they can come to you and help solve that issue without an arrest or violence. They talk you down. Barb Gerardin is an amazing officer, and she's one in Green Bay that does a lot of really good work.
And then what was the second question?
Trauma-informed care in schools.
Okay.
Because this lovely lady just talked about, a 7-year-old doesn't want to go into a school. He's traumatized. What can we do to bring that trauma-informed care to those teachers in the school so that we can get kids back in the classroom.
Yeah, I mean, that. I think that goes right along with my number six proposal, was the mental health treatment aspect, and that funding that kind of is it a police officer or more of a counselor?
It is a police officer for CIT. Trauma-informed care, anybody can do, whether it is a counselor or a teacher. It's just making sure that you have the training, whomever you are, parent, teacher, counselor, officer in the school to help those kids.
Yeah, I mean, those sound like they go right along with empowering law enforcement to protect our children and increasing the mental health treatment in the country. And what was number third one?
What do you think city and county officials should be doing to help move this along?
The city and county officials can be allocating resources to the officers also. And honestly, just from what I'm following, it sounds like they're the ones doing the most action at this point. So, yeah, a lot of them are directly in charge of the police forces in the community. So they can be allocating resources to empower the law enforcement officers.
Thank you.
Actually, you want a question up here, right? Okay.
Going off of her comment about the threats made at schools, it wasn't even a week after the Parkland shooting when somebody made a threat to my school, Ashwaubenon, and we had to go on lockdown for the day. And I was just wondering what you suggest is a good way to handle those type of threats. I know it's a very difficult thing because you can't ignore them, but you can't have police there like all week or whatever. So I was just wondering how you think it should be handled. It's a difficult situation.
Yeah, obviously every potential threat should be taken seriously, and the police liaison officer. I hope there is there one at your school. Okay, there is one. There is one at their school. Hopefully, the police officer, the police liaison officer, has the knowledge of the students there and knowledge of the potential access points at the school to be able to make the students feel safe. And I would think that the law enforcement department would allocate extra resources to that school for that day based on that threat, so that everybody feels safe to go to school. And I would encourage the students to communicate with themselves, and if they see something that seems out of the ordinary, to report that to a teacher or the liaison officer.
Hi, Bo. My name is Kristen Carnes. I live in Dupina, and I am a Southwest grad as well, so we're friends. Just wondering what your position is on the banning of sales at gun shows.
I remember that I believe in universal background checks and universal waiting periods. So if there's a sale there, they should have to go through a background check, and there should be a waiting period.
Hi, well, my name is Lynn Adrian, and I am from the Denmark area, and am a retired teacher of a high school where a stabbing took place. And trauma still exists, you know, with the teachers and with the students. And what would have happened if it had been, you know, lazy. The second thing is that Mueller right now is investigating Russia's participation in the NRA, which is a, you know, I don't even know where to say anything, but I'm, you know, waiting for this to be figured out. And I think the gentleman who said that we only have a couple million who are part of the NRA, and look at all the individuals who are affected by guns. And I would go along with a repeal, but I think that one of the women who talked about the bans on the AR-15s and AK-47s just feels like it needs to take shape. And yes, you said there would be a lot of resistance. Yes, and we have these students who are leading us 15, 16, excuse me, and 17-year-olds who ourselves and to protect all of our children.
You didn't want to respond? Or?
Yeah, just a quick comment, trying to pick something out there. I think there's a significant problem with money in politics in general. Yes. I'm not going to limit it to the NRA. So I think every dollar that goes through our political process should be accounted for and the public have access to viewing. And we just don't have that right now. So.
My name is Lisa Tillamacuff. I'm from Appleton, Wisconsin, and I'd also like to thank you for being here today, as our congressional representative could not find the time to be here. I'm concerned, first of all, about framing this discussion, any sort of framing that involves being fearful of alienating gun owners. I think that if we had worried about alienating smokers, we wouldn't have some of the healthy laws that we have in this state right now. Go outside of the state to other states that don't have those laws and you'll be shocked at what it's like to step into a restaurant or a bar or anywhere else where there's a lot of heavy smoking. I have friends who smoke and they smoke in their own homes and that's fine. But I think that the important thing also to remember, and I guess my whole thing that I want to say is more a comment than a question, is that there are mental health issues all around the world. But there are gun violence like we have here in the United States. And that being said, although they've now allowed us to, they've clarified what the rules are as far as joint investigations and gun violence, it's still not something that is permitted to be done across the board, across the United States. And without that kind of investigation in gun violence and the impact on the schools and the impacts on our communities, we're not going to go anywhere. So I would like to suggest that when you become our congressional representative, let's talk more about educating ourselves and educating gun owners about what those rights mean and what sort of responsibilities come with it. And I think that in a large part, you're on the right track.
Yeah, thank you so much for coming. Thank you.
You have a thankless job. Thank you for coming. And there's a couple things that's been going on in my mind as far as what we can do about some of the gun problem. Is we need to work more with those local legislators. Like we saw this example about recent decision in Massachusetts or whatever that was. That was not at a congressional level. That was at a local level. We need to talk to our local people. Give him a break. He's got so much more to worry about. He needs to be concerned about authenticity and not fake news from a fake president. Thank you.
Occasionally, I do call my senators, my congressmen, my local people, not usually speaking to them, but through their staffers, about some particular bill. I feel like I get just kind of a mishmash of call about this bill or that bill. And I'm wondering now, since we're all here together, can we organize some sort of media, social media, so that we know who to call, not everyone does, and what bills are up, Senate bill, Assembly bill, et cetera.
Hello, Beth Paulson, Moms Command Action, Green Bay, Wisconsin, also Southwest grad, Go Trojans. I'm here, and also my colleague Sandy Rode is here, and our group is really good about getting pushes out, so if you want to be like on our email list or be a part of our Facebook group. Sandy is from Appleton, the Fox Valley area, and I'm the Green Bay person, and we're really good about acting quickly and motivating people. As soon as something bad or good comes our way, we'll say, okay, call your legislator now. So, Moms Demand Action is a great place to start. You don't have to be a mom, you don't have to be even a dad, you just have to be a person who cares about this.
Yay!
Hi, I'm Julie. I just wanted to add on to what she was saying. There's also, besides signing up with them and getting their pushes, there's an app called Countable, which is absolutely amazing. You can actually contact your representatives right through it. You sign up, it tells you all the bills that are going in front of the Senate and the House. It connects you to your leaders, so it's pushed out to all of your congressional reps at one time. And it gives you a lot of information and lets you provide feedback as well. So it's just another way. And I also wanted to just, I had a question for you actually too, just to build on some of the comments about the NRA and the Second Amendment. Part of my expertise as a lawyer is in constitutional law, so I fully realize we are never probably repealing the Second Amendment, despite its misinterpretations, I would say, that go around. But the bigger issue, I think, is that we as a country have allowed the NRA to frame our debate on gun law, and by saying things like we're going to alienate gun owners, that sort of thing. Every gun owner I know that I've spoken with and I've had lengthy conversations, they are very much in favor of all the stuff you're recommending. They understand like what they're using the guns for. There's very few people around here that unreasonable about it. So I think what we need to do, and this is my question for you, if we send you to Congress, what can you do on your part, or what would you tell your constituents to do to help diminish the power of the NRA, because they are way too influential in the legislative process right now? So what could you, what would you do on your part, or what could we do to help make them less powerful?
Well, I know from my perspective, I'm going to be fighting for the six things that I mentioned to you tonight. These aren't just things that I'm saying off the cuff. I think these are common sense gun violence prevention measures that the vast majority of people agree with. And I feel totally comfortable going to Congress and actually fighting for them instead of just doing nothing like they're doing right now. As far as, I'll give the same answer kind of that I gave on the question back here, is that, you have a First Amendment right, and you should be exercising that whenever you want, however you want. So that's all I can say is that, and when I'm your congressman next year, call my office and tell me whether I'm doing a good job or a bad job. So, and just continue making your voice be heard.
So we have a student question.
I was wondering about your thoughts about the people who say how these shootings could have just been prevented if we were just nicer to the kid. I really feel like that's ridiculous that we now all of a sudden have to be mental health teachers. I wonder what you want to say about that.
Yeah, very good question. I think it's to gauge it that way. I'm not sure what the exact quote was. So I'm just kind of responding to your question. If it's gauged that way, I think that's insulting to you. I mean, your only objective should be to get a high school education when you're at school, and that they think that you should be a mental health counselor is kind of ridiculous. But that said, on the other half of that, I do know that bullying is a significant problem too, and it has been since I've been in high school. So the other half of that is I think that we should end bullying and stop being mean to each other and tweeting out mean tweets. And did that answer your question?
That comes from a right-wing campaign that wanted to blame students at Parkland for having tormented Nicholas Cruz, when there actually wasn't evidence that had occurred. So it was a way to try to smear Parkland students where that started. It was quite widespread.
Thank you.
I know I had a turn already, so if somebody else is waiting, come and take the microphone from you. I just wanted to encourage everyone to think about the gun violence prevention a little broader. We're very, very focused on schools right now, and a lot of the solutions that some people are offering are trying to offer solutions like students being nicer to each other or arming teachers, whereas we've had gun violence prevention in our communities, in churches, and movie theaters, as you alluded to earlier, at colleges, and even at military bases. You know, it is not isolated in schools. It's actually a symptom of, culture of violence and a culture of fear that has been cultivated instead of a common sense of community. The other thing I just wanted to kind of enter into the discussion is that in Wisconsin, nearly three-fourths of our gun violence deaths
are suicide. So the idea of, you know, helping people get proper treatment is a really vital part of the conversation for our particular state. And then there are lots of groups. I've been working on the gun violence prevention issue for about 5 years. And there are many, many organizations in the country. And if you look even at the town hall site that the students have set up right now, there's lots of them listed. We're all on the same team and we're all working together, but there's a state-by-state kind of patchwork. And so until we have federal solutions, it's really important to know what's happening in our state. And Montana Action is one group that works on that. I'm a member of another group called Wisconsin Anti-Violence Effort that has worked in collaboration with lots of players at the state level to help craft legislation that would fill holes in the systems we have in place in Wisconsin. And so it's really important to know that, but if we could have a federal background check, then we don't have to do that state by state. So we really, you know, it would be wonderful. And as the woman in the back has expressed, it's heartbreaking that the children are having to call on the adults to be the adults. It's really our job to keep the kids safe. It's not their responsibility, it's our responsibility. And so if you can help bring that kind of responsibility and responsiveness, it would be wonderful. The other just comment that, you know, starting where we do have consensus, I think is a really smart strategy. There's lots of polling data that show huge majorities of the population, whether they're gun owners or not, or NRA members or not, are in favor of that universal background check. It's the evidence-based thing that we can do, and there's just tremendous, like I said, super majorities. So I really hope you'll help us do that.
That one thing that really affects me is the fact that gun manufacturers are getting filthy rich over gun sales while we are in our communities are having to stretch our resources so thin to try to manage the damage of gun violence. And I'm curious, you know, if something like a sin tax on gun sales or gun manufacturers to help fund those mental health services so we could have a mental health clinic on every single corner in our community, in every single school. We could have, you know, one mental health officer for every 100 students. You know, I would just love to see exponentially more mental health services. And I'm wondering if you think we have the funds to do it right now, because I hear a lot of talk about it, but I also don't see a lot of it in my community. So like, is the funding the problem? And if so, would something like a sin tax on gun sales be something that Congress might consider someday, in your opinion?
Yeah. I guess I'm going to go back to my original six policy proposals. I think if we're talking about a tax, that we're going to lose a significant number of people from the supermajority that I think there are in the six proposals that I have. So I'm focusing on those six proposals. But what I do know is we need an investment in our mental health system because it is significant. I know it from my everyday job that, I mean, we just needed a significant investment in it. So that's what I can say, and that's what I'm going to fight for when I'm in Congress.
I'm Nicole Nauer from New Bay. I know that you say that you're for the liaison, which is at school, which is fine. But a handgun against a machine gun, how does that work? How many liaison officers are you going to decide are going to be in school? The schools are pretty large. One for each school? Is that enough? Okay. How are you going to decide that? Who's going to pay for it? The schools are staffed already.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, thank you.
They're not going to do it for free. One more thing, I want to say thank you to this gentleman over here that's a gun owner that is sensible and he is standing up for things that things that are right. And I think more gun owners who say that they are law-abiding should be standing up and saying, we want to protect the guns. So how are we going to do this? You know, we've got to do something about it, and we've got to get rid of the bad guys that should have. So I think law-abiding government should unite and do something.
I'm using the term empowering our law enforcement officers because they are the experts, and I want them to evaluate each school individually and make those determinations and those questions that you originally have. Because I mean, some schools are very large with thousands of students, and some schools are very small with only a couple hundred students. So that's why I'm specifically using the term empower our law enforcement to evaluate those things and make those decisions. And it'll require funding to do that.
I'm Joanne Kulski from DePere. Julie asked the question, how do we release the grip of the NRA? I have one word, vote. Yes. Every time I vote out a congressman was willing to take money from the NRA, we're loosening their grip on this country.
We got another one up here.
I just wanted to comment when we did the walkout at our school on, I don't remember what day that was, the speaker who was like announcing said that in the 2020 election, three-fourths of high school students will be able to vote, current high school students. So I think that will be, just knowing like the demographic at my school, I think that will definitely be the change that we want, hopefully. But that's a lot of people, a lot of Democrats to vote.
Hi, I'm Wayne Chiminski from Craigtown, Surrey, Wisconsin, up north. Anyway, when my son, who's now in his 30s, was 6 years old, we were in Lake Tahoe, and he had been playing with a youngster across the street and came home with a toy gun that looked very real to me, but I took it and I said to him, I said, you know, you can't keep this. And he said, well, he gave it to me. And I said, well, you can't keep this gun. And my wife was sitting at the couch, and she said the same thing, you have to take that gun right back, that toy gun right back. And he picked up that gun, and he went right up to her head. And I saw the wildness, the anger in his eyes. And when he pulled that trigger, I just said, my mouth dropped open, I grabbed him, I took him to the bedroom, I said, you have to stay here, and I'll deal with you later. When I came back, I said, no, you have to take that gun. I marched him across the street and gave him, and we had never allowed toy guns in our house. But the thing is I pressed on him, I said, if that had been a real gun, your mother would be dead. And ever since then, to this day, I don't own a handgun. And I know we have a lot of handguns out there. We have a lot of gun owners, and we have them in families that do have young kids. Now this, my son was only 6 years old, and he already had that fascination. So I think we need education with gun owners, number one, that these guns have got to be locked up in a gun safe, not in a cabinet with a glass front on display, but in a safe, secure place if they're going to have a gun. And I think we should come up with some kind of law. If they can buy a gun like that and afford to have that gun in the house, it should be locked up. It is a very, very secure place. And we need education, and we need a law that backs it up.
Yeah, thank you.
Smart. So the Be Smart program actually goes out and talks to anybody that let us talk to them, but it's like churches or schools or PTAs or whatever, and it is exactly that. Like safe storage, safe handling of guns, so that we prevent that accidental stuff that happens with the buildings at home.
And I don't even need the microphone. Just to add to that, one of the points they make is when your children are going to someone's house to play, find out if the house they're going to has guns, and how do they store them.
Okay,
I was just wondering what your viewpoint is on, like, you know, how people always say that violent video games, violent movies, or whatever may cause kids, like he was talking about, these like 6-year-olds that see a toy gun and put it up to their mom's head. Do you think that those violent video games and whatever they're supposed to have an effect on that at all?
That's an excellent question. I think it should be part of the research that should be done into this entire issue. I know when I was growing up, my mom would let me play football and baseball video games. So it was I don't even know how to begin to answer the question myself without actually, because I've never done a study myself, and I don't know if there even are studies out there on that issue. So, but I think it should be a part of the study that they've been preventing for years. So,
I think just to comment as a criminologist, there's a lot of studies on that. The studies at sort of small group levels are inconclusive, but the overall epidemiological data shows a sharp decline in violent gun deaths when there are more video games. And there's actually a real basic reason for that. Kids who play video games constantly are inside. And violence tends to happen, epidemiological terms, tends to happen when people are out. And part of the reason why we've seen such a dramatic decline in violence over the past 4 years has been a changed lifestyle. So, I mean, if you're interested, you can talk to me more about that kind of research. But I have another question.
I don't really have a question for you. I just want to encourage everyone who's here to come to West High School on April 16th at 6 o'clock. The Green Bay School District is going to have a roundtable discussions about gun violence in our schools. Please come and give your input. The more people that come, the better. Please come.
On the assault weapons ban, I understand you're concerned about getting support for it, but in 2004, when the assault weapons ban expired, we saw a very dramatic increase in mass shootings. Studies have found between 186% to 200% increase since 2004. And the assault weapons ban, when it was put in place, actually sharply reduced mass death. So I guess the question I would ask you, since you said you're reluctant about pursuing the assault weapons ban, when you get to Congress, will you make an effort to appropriate money for research into this question? Because as we move forward, I believe facts play a very powerful role. And you can read in the literature some controversy about what we should, you know, what kind of interpretation should we draw from that weapons. But I think that a significant investment in that question could resolve that controversy, and then perhaps we could get the support I think you're worried about having on the assault weapons ban. Does that sound like something you would?
I certainly support the research into the issue. I'll say it again, I think that's one of the fundamental failings of this particular Congress, is that they don't have any public open hearings on anything of significance since they've taken office in last January. They didn't have any public hearings on the health care bill, they didn't have any public hearings on the tax bill, and I don't expect them to have any hearings or authorizing the research, real research on this issue as well. So yes, I absolutely support research.
Great, thank you.
Don't worry, we're gonna vote Paul Ryan too.
There's been a lot of discussion about guns, and there was some discussion about a sin tax, which I absolutely agree with. But what we haven't heard, and I very rarely hear, is what kinds of controls that are outside the scope of the Second Amendment can be placed on ammunition. We place sin taxes on alcohol, we place sin taxes on tobacco products. And I think if there is the potential for an opening here, it is to place a sin tax on ammunition. In each case that we have these mass shootings, the shooter has amassed thousands of rounds of ammunition. And this can be stopped. If it was up to me, we'd have 1,000% tax on every damn bullet that's sold in this country. And perhaps if we can't whittle away at the NRA and the gun lobby, perhaps we can approach this a little bit differently and start to come at it from the standpoint of ammunition.
It is altogether too easy and too cheap for a person to walk into Fleet Farm or Cabela's or any of these places and walk out with boxes of ammunition. And if they could not afford it, if they couldn't afford to amass that kind of a stockpile, maybe, just maybe, one life could be saved. And if one life could be saved, I would say it's well worth putting a tax on people who through their own paranoia and mental disease, have this need to not only stockpile weapons, but to have enough bullets to go to war with. And I understand your concern to talk about the Second Amendment. I understand that. You're in a difficult spot. But perhaps you and other open-minded progressives could talk about other avenues of control.
I have one more question before we get close to wrapping it up. I'll give you a chance to make some final remarks.
I go Dan Wilson from Appleton. In 2005, Congress passed a bill in the Bush administration that exempted firearm manufacturers and dealers from civil lawsuits. No other product enjoys that protection. Now, the reason we don't have lawn darts is because thousands of people were killed and injured, and then retailers and manufacturers got sued. So my question is, would you support repealing that law, or, in the alternative, reclassify firearms as lawn darts?
This is honestly the first time that I'm hearing about this particular law, so I would have to read it. I mean, I'm a prosecutor, I actually read laws. Thank you for commenting. I'll have my staff look at this.
I think, from what I've heard, you've expanded your list to 11 or 12 or 13 things by now. You're probably short on the assault rifle, I really think. When the AR-15 was designed, actually, in the late 1950s, they also designed, the military asked for a round that had more killing power than anything out there. And that's why the 223 round was great. Now we have something like 200 brands of assault rifles out there, and the previous bans have described the assault rifle physically, but not by the round they fire. A ban on the ammunition or firearms that fire that military grade ammunition would go a lot farther. There's no reason for AR-15. It's not even practical for hunting. It has no other reason other than to kill human beings. Okay? Now, if we went to my first suggestion of removing that exemption from gun dealers and manufacturers, I don't think we need any damn laws, you know? It would put them out of business. And I think we have to approach firearms like any other product out there. They're not meant to kill people. That's what they're designed to do. That's all I got to say.
Thank you.
Okay, this will be the last question.
I think I agree with Dan. Sorry, Lauren Prince, Iowa, Wisconsin. I agree with Dan, fall a little short on some of the assault weapons banning questions that you've been approached with. I think you did ignite a lot more passion from the group. If you were more open to that, a little firmer on that. But I guess to his question about the research, if the research did come back, which you support, as you've said, that significantly we could see an increase or decrease in gun violence from assault and what would your support be then after that research comes out? Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for stepping up and asking the question. I'm not going to have a comment about it until I actually see the results of the research. I think that's the whole point of having research. What I will tell you is that you're going to find in that 7 months that I'm a practical solutions type of guy, and I'm not going to take a position on banning any specific firearm, because I want the six things that I propose here today to actually become law in this country, and that's what I'm going to focus on, that's what I think all of you should focus on, and that's what I'm going to fight for when I'm
I have a question about the Second Amendment. Do you think the way the Second Amendment has been viewed by Americans changed over time? I mean, not like from way back when the Constitution was actually created. I mean, like, what has changed since, like, the 50s or, like, late 20th century? Do you think that has been changed, the way Americans view it?
Yeah, very philosophical question there. Wow. It's a pretty simple amendment when you read it. I mean, what has changed is firearm technology itself, and I mean, it's fully automatic assault weapons are prohibited by law and have been prohibited by law for a long time. So I mean, that's something that was 100 years ago a reasonable common sense solution to gun violence back then. So. And I think that we need to get back to that with the six things that I proposed here today, which I think are reasonable, common sense solutions.
So,
Bo,
did you want to make some closing remarks
before we... No, just saying thank you for letting me come out here and address you today. You participated in your democracy today. I think it's totally awesome. I'm very, very happy to see a nice crowd out here today. And I mean, who thinks that their elected representatives should have town halls every once in a while?